Wow, this show here tonight could go in a whole host of directions, but I want to ask you what actually first got you into this line of work, James?
I always wanted to be an author, and I refused to do it because I didn't have the skill set when I was young. I was always kind of wanting to be a writer when I was early 20s, but I wasn't stupid either. I knew I had an academic skill set as an engineer and science, and that was my vocation. And I went, I'm not a writer, I'm a scientist, I'm an engineer, and I put my eggs in that basket, and I pursued that. The reason I wanted to be a writer was I had been reading. I'm an avid reader of all sorts of mysteries, megaliths, anomalies, ancient Egypt, Babylonian, Sumerians, anything to do with ancient civilizations. I like from the Romans and beyond. Anything after the Romans, I don't like. That's my personal, that's my personal hobby to research ancient civilizations. It's always been in me. But I'm good at math and I'm good at science, and I need to work, and that's what I put my my energy into when I was in my 20s. However, I kind of came back to where my roots was in a way, and I found myself researching megaliths for all the wrong reasons. I never ever thought I would be writing about megaliths one day. By the time I was 30, for a multitude of reasons, I won't get into them all, but there is a couple. But for a multitude of reasons, I found myself researching in everything that I do, my science, my engineering, and my skill set, researching as a systems analyst, all came into play. And then I put the whole thing together to research the megaliths, and it's like I have all my skills and passions all in one now, and it's just a wonderful woven mix of everything I am and everything who I am. There was one incident where I found rock art in Donegal in the northwest of Ireland, not properly documented, and it was not in the record as being recorded as the rock art of the constellation Ursa Major, Ursa Minor, and particularly to an equinox flipping between every 21st of March, every 21st of September. Now, I have that in my book. It's called the Ardmore Equinox Stone. It's a bit of a discovery. It's not something you can write a book on. I thought it was a curious anomaly. I researched the record. I couldn't find anything about it. And this was about 2007. So that was one major thing. I had a serendipitous event why I was actually researching that rock art. Long story short, I bought a really rare book when I couldn't even afford to buy, my dinners that time. I was struggling to eat, and I bought a $150 book. But I used to research rare books and buy. It's an addiction I have to buying rare books, and it comes from America, and it was it's called Hamlet's Mill. Hershey von Decker and Giorgio de Santillano, researching ancient astronomy and ancient cultures all around the world and mythologies and linking it all together, and it's like the archaeoastronomy Bible, if you will. And I got a copy, comes from America, out pops when it gets here, out pops a photocopy from a New Scientist magazine from 1976, July, the year and month I was born. I went, wow, what the hell is this? And when I looked in it gave me this location of this piece of rock art in Donegal, and I couldn't believe it. I went, oh, that's just across the loch, that's just across the water from where I'm at. I went on a 50-mile cycle. I love cycling, and I went on this 50-mile cycle around the lock, and I called in halfway around it. And when I got there, I was stunned. Great, beautiful rock art constellations. This is great. I didn't know we had this in our backyard. It's only when I went home that I tried to research thing. I couldn't find anything on it. Now, I had looked at megaliths when I was from a teenager till I was in my mid-20s. I hadn't got the academic interest in it, but I had since done an astronomy degree, not for the pursuit of my career that I'm in now. It's just I wanted to make a change from engineering, and I ended up researching rock art as a result of this constellation. It's just ironic that, for all the wrong reasons I was there, but I had all the right skill sets at that time. And perhaps that serendipity was a moment of truth in my life. I don't know. I don't believe in coincidences. I think.
No, I think you were definitely on the correct path, James. And the fact you got that book so randomly and then you were pointed in that direction, we call that a synchronicity here on TFR. And it seems to be that when people are on the right path, these little nuggets are left for us along the way.
It really did change everything for me. I mean, what I realized there and then was that it wasn't in the record, that it wasn't documented. I went, And the first thing I questioned myself was, I go, well, what else isn't documented? Obviously, I'm a problem solver. I'm like, well, you know, if I can find this in 2007, what else is out there? Now, I never did find anything in terms of an apparent, obvious revelation. But I did find other concepts. I did find other research not done very well, sometimes totally erroneous. And sometimes people had missed the whole point. I should comment on my career. Why I do things differently is because I'm a systems analyst. I didn't start off as a systems analyst. I worked my way up to that. I started off as a time-served engineer, electromechanical. I've worked in electrical systems, electronic systems, and mechanical systems. I'm quite involved in my career, and that's why I have all those qualifications. In the end, I wanted to get out of the mechanical engineering. It's my highest qualification is Master's Mechanical Engineering. And I wanted to do something different, and I wanted to get into science. So I did a physics with astronomy degree. And that's when I got into the systems science and systems analyst in engineering. And that was great. And I just wanted to break free from that. And I was actually going to go into medical physics. It meant going to the Middle East to do a PhD course out there. And I didn't really want to go. It was just ironic at that time when that book landed in my lap. And I was back home. I had been in the British Isles, north, south, east and west. I'd been away for about 12 years. And I found myself back home for a short period of time. And like you say, it wasn't just the synchronicity of the book. It was the synchronicity of everything in my life. Coming back home, being in that location, having the book there. It was like all roads head to Rome in a way. But I did. I sat down with my problem-solving skill set as a systems analyst. And I used to work in some massive complexes. I mean, I worked in the most automated place in Britain at one point in my career, mostly wind farms, power plants, water treatments, timber industry, anything that was really majorly complex in engineering. I went into those electrical mechanical systems and I looked at computer-run environments. I would look at the anomalies, problems that would arise and try and weed those problems out and redesign the system, do whatever I had to do. And that's why I loved the complexity of that. At that stage, I couldn't evolve myself anymore in my career, and that's why I wanted out of it. But I loved that part of my career, problem solving and complexity. So when I found myself looking at the megaliths, guys, I'm like, wow, I've just found something here. And I realized something very, very crucial. Nobody else, very, very few people, and I have actually come across recently one other systems analyst, systems scientist, who does exactly what I do for megaliths. And I just think it's ironic that I actually meet somebody like me in the field. I just thought I was
unique. I think it must give you the perfect way of thinking about these things, because basically you're a detective in some ways, James.
It is a detective process. That's exactly what it is, Kevin. And the thing is, we're looking at a very, very fragmented story. What is left of the megaliths is a process of decay. You've got very, very, you know, give it a scale of 1 to 5, a good condition of monuments, yeah? You know, you've got everything from 1 decimated to 2, okay, 3, average, 4, pretty good condition, and then 5 in excellent condition. So, you know, they're in various states of decay. So you're looking at a decaying process of these megaliths. Some of these tombs and stuff that I researched is like have no roofs. Some of them have roofs. The art is starting to get washed away. So you're looking at just basically the remnants of what's left, and you're trying to peer into the past. What I realized was, in Ireland, we're sitting with 45% of the rock art of the whole of Europe in one location within a 2-mile radius.
Wait, and that's 45% of all the rock art in Europe
is in one location in Ireland. That's within 2 miles of Newgrange, in a 2-mile radius of Newgrange. That's how much rock art is there. That tells a massive part of the story, guys, okay? You got to realize that first and foremost. Yorkshire's got quite a lot too, as does Scotland. There's pockets of it here and there, a little bit in Wales as well, in Anglesey. But for the best part, like 45% of it is in Ireland. Now, I'm not talking about painted art. I'm talking about chiseled into rock, as in rock art, carved rock art. Now, the beautiful thing about that is art tells a story. There's an interpretation there. And when the art is representing astronomy and you have the science of astronomy, well, then you've got a really good interpretation of what's going on. I'm talking about lunar calculations, solar calculations, constellations being represented, alignments. So there's a lot of body of research. So I'm like going, okay, well, this is great. I found this rock art. Let's see what else is there in terms of constellations. And I can actually only find two clear representations of constellations in the megalithic culture. That is the constellation of Ursa Major, Ursa Minor in Ardmore Rock Art, Donegal, and the Pleiades constellation in Doth in County Meath. Apart from that, there is other ones that you could say is maybe Orion or maybe Sirius or maybe this or maybe that, but them two is a definite. The rest is open to interpretation.
Why is it the Pleiades always seems to crop up when you talk about ancient civilizations?
It's always the Pleiades, it's always Orion, and it's always Sirius. And the funny thing is, they're all in a straight line. I don't know if you're aware of that. If you don't know your astronomy, let me just give you, if you look at Orion's belt, the three bell stars of Orion, if you follow them upwards in a line, you will hit the Pleiades. And the three bell stars of Orion, if you follow them downwards at an angle, you'll hit the star Sirius. So these three that are inherent in most mythologies and cultures around the world are all in a straight line. In the same region of the sky, in other words. There's folklore that we come from the Pleiades and we come from Sirius, and that's what the Egyptians wrote about. That's what the Dogon wrote about. That's a whole other minefield of research. But when I found myself looking at this rock art, I realized something else. A lot of the rock art is at passage tombs. And passage tombs, this might seem like very obvious to people, but some people miss this point. The passage tombs have a long passageway. And the passageway goes into a central chamber inside this mound. And a beam of sunlight usually comes in the passageway and illuminates these chambers on the inside. So we know they were aligning these chambers to something on the horizon, most notably the sun. It wasn't just the sun, though. Some of them are open to stellar alignments. Some people think it's the moon, and some people also think they're aligned to Venus as well. But regardless of what they're aligned to something. The idea is that sun, moon, or starlight would enter these chambers. Now, when you realize that, you also have something that's left, is the passageway is left. Most times the roof's caved in or whatever, but you have the alignment of the passageway. So we have art that with astronomical calculations that we can figure out, and we also have alignments, and we have sometimes both. We have the art and the alignments of the passageways all in the one location. Now that tells a really big part of the story. That gives you something to bite into, and that's what I realized, that nobody really was looking at the megalithic civilization, particularly passage graves and the art all together, all across the whole island and Europe for that matter, with what I would call a passage grave cosmology. What you do find is, in fairness, you find authors will flock to Newgrange, or they'll go to Maidstone, Scotland, or they'll go to Avebury or to Stonehenge, or you know, they'll single out one monument and they're going to crack the civilization by looking at one monument. And that's just, you know, it just doesn't work. You're not going to get the big picture.
You can't form any patterns that way. You can't see any kind of common traits.
You don't see behaviorism. You don't see any patterns. And I find, and I'm still doing research today, guys. I've been at this megalithic stuff 15 years, academically 7. But I have worked all over the British Isles. I've been north, south, east, and west. I've lived in the Outer Hebrides. I lived in Cornwall. I lived in Wales. I lived in very remote areas doing remote engineering projects like wind farms and water treatments. I was just blessed that that's the same as the megalithic territory. So I used to, quote, goof off these monuments when I was younger, going around working. And I would just always seek them out. But I never thought I would be researching them academically. So I was very privileged to be in these remote places and see these places with my eye. Most of them I have gone back to and revisited for an academic reason. But the point is, very few people go to all these places. Very few people have the will or the desire to research the complexity of this problem. And it is a problem. I mean, there's something like 25,000 megalithic sites across the whole of Europe, Western Europe. It's on a scale that's unprecedented. It's just mind-boggling, the amount of sites. You're talking stone circles, you're talking stone rows, megalithic tombs of various, from long barrows, passage tombs, court tombs.
You mentioned circles there, James. Sorry for cutting you off, but that makes me automatically think of Michael Tellinger's work down on the African continent.
I met Michael in Bosnia there. I was in Bosnia with Michael not too long ago, a couple of months ago. Fascinating guy. I love Michael's work, and Michael researches the astronomy and the acoustics as well. Something I've got into as well is the acoustics of these monuments. I mentioned the astronomy. There's an incredible amount of astronomical evidence suggesting what these guys were doing in terms of the astronomy. What's harder to realize is the acoustics of these monuments too. We see the astronomy, we understand astronomy, we look up, we see the stars, we look at the constellation rock art, we can get it, we can understand it. When you see lunar counts of 19 encoded in the stones, when you see the monuments aligned to, especially up where you guys are at in Scotland, you have recumbent stone circles. Something like 99 of these have been recorded in around the Aberdeen area. And they're only home to Scotland and Aberdeen and that territory, and they occur nowhere else in the megalithic civilization. There is no real reason why this happens. Again, in Northern Ireland, where I'm at today, you have what's called court tombs. Basically, it looks like there's a courtyard on the attached to the entrance of this alignment of this tomb. Now, I say it looks like it because I don't believe it was a courtyard. I believe it was a semicircular astronomical observatory to measure circumpolar. It's a whole minefield of research to get into, but basically anything to do with a circle or a semicircle is bringing a horizon down to ground level. Same as all these henges are circular or oval. If you want to bring the horizon down to ground level, the best way to do that is map out a circle. You can measure southeast, southwest for the sunrise on the winter and summer solstice, and summer, winter, sunrise and sunset, and northeast and northwest for the summer solstice, sunrise and sunset, and then east and west for the equinoxes. So we have these cardinal points, and we have all this, you know, basic body of knowledge for solstices and equinoxes and astronomical evidence. But what's harder to perceive, because it takes conceptual evidence, is this evidence of acoustics. Some of, again, the best of for this is up in Maze Hill in the Orkneys, and Dr. Rupert Till's. He's done a minefield of research. He's done some stuff at Stonehenge as well. Most people don't realize the Stonehenge is an acoustic auditorium as well as a solar and lunar observatory. These monuments have levels of complexity we're still struggling to understand. You know, and like I say, that's great that other authors do go to like sort of Stonehenge. There's so much in Stonehenge. It takes a book on Stonehenge to even understand it. It takes maybe two, you maybe one on astronomy and one on acoustics. However, it doesn't serve to understand or peer into the past. Just for example, the horseshoe at Stonehenge, it give you examples, they're flat on one side and rough on the other. It's like they're curved like a parabolic mirror to focus sound. As well as that, because the standing stones are in a circle, it affects the sound traveling from the center of the circle outwards. So if you had a drum beat or somebody chanting or whatever sort of sound source there was, the sound will hit the stones and coalesce and move around it, and an effect of constructive and destructive interference in wave patterns.
And what amazes me as well is the fact that they managed to somehow, I mean, these ancient cultures, they lined up these stones magnetically polarized at the north-south, north-south.
Yeah, again, another minefield of research. Some of them even have radiation bands. Maria Wheatley would have done a lot of that at Avebury too. Here's the thing, right? You've got astronomy, you have acoustics, you have the magnetics of the stones. Even some people said that there's radiation bands. How do they know all this? I think there is always reasoning. Perhaps they built these passageways, these long passageways going to inner chambers, to make sure that the beam of sunlight would be thin enough to hit the back stone to do something with. There's a very practical reason for building a long passageway. However, when you build a long passageway going into a central chamber, you have naturally created what's called a Helmholtz resonator. Dr. Rupert Till would have done this at Maze Hill in Orkney. He did tests and showed that it acts like a Helmholtz resonator. Without getting too scientific, is basically when you blow into a neck of a bottle, you're blowing into a Helmholtz resonator. And that's when you blow into the neck of a bottle, you can make a sound like a note. You can blow in the bottle and create a note. That's the most basic example of a Helmholtz resonator. What you also see is some of these chambers have recesses going off, and the recesses have not a doorway going into them, but an aperture. Like you have to step over a little sill, and you have to put your head under a head sill as well. So you're going through a little hole into a room. It's like the sound box on a guitar. Again, resonance kicks in there too. So it looks like these guys were exploring the effects of sound. Maybe they built long passageways going into chambers for a reason for astronomy and created some sort of an acoustic result. Another great example is what we see is acoustic waves being drawn as rock art as well. Another natural example, let's say these guys were burning incense or something like that. You would have actually seen the resonance of the wave literally standing in the air, what we call a standing wave, a zigzag up and down sine wave. You would have seen that in the smoke particles. This is an effect that occurs at churches today. When you see resonance occur in a church, even during Mass, people will notice when they burn the incense, if the choir sings, you will see waves being set up in the pattern. It's a known effect that occurs at churches today. So there may be natural effects while these guys are discovering sound waves. There may be natural reasons why they set up that the chambers in a certain way. And then later, there could be a natural discovery process. People struggle with this stuff because they just think it's making the ancients too evolved or too high-tech. There may be natural reasons for that. They may have been given the knowledge as well. I'm not ruling that one out either. But I like to say, if there is a natural discovery process, point that out. And I do think there's great examples of that. But I do know that these guys had a very evolved concept of acoustics, and they had a very evolved concept of astronomy. High-tech stuff with very mundane building materials. I mean, these guys just used stone, earth, and mud and did some really sophisticated stuff with it.
I find it absolutely fascinating, you know, all this ancient technology and stuff like that, and the way that they did things. You know, it's like we watched a documentary a while back, ancient cymatics, mm-hmm. stuff, and all the, you know, I lost my train of thought there. But
the break has caught up on you, and that has definitely been the fastest first half to a show yet. James Swagger, folks, what information. I think we're going to kidnap this guy for the show. Join us straight after the break and we'll get right back into this. Don't go anywhere.
This is the Kev Baker Show.
Welcome back to the Kev Baker Show, folks, here on the True Frequency Radio Network. Tonight, I'm absolutely blown away by our guest, Mr. James Swagger. The information and knowledge he's presenting is something else. Now, before the break, I kind of lost my train of thought, where we were talking about cymatics and basically how sound waves can actually change the molecular structure of stuff. And you see all these sacred geometry patterns and stuff that I find absolutely fascinating. And just in the break, I think, James, you were talking about somewhere that you went and you actually seen this done live.
Oh, sure. Yeah. You know, it's actually quite an easy experiment to set up. Basically, you can do it with sand. You can get kits, cymatic kits, to demonstrate this. It's just mind-blowing when you see cymatics done and what it actually, the patterns of what sound is basically geometry. It's a hard concept to grasp with. There's a great YouTube video called Sonic Geometry if anyone wants to look it up. Fascinating. But yeah, I mean, basically you can turn sound into geometry. And when you realize that and you realize what sound waves are, I mean, it just links up mathematics, acoustics and geometry all into one. I mean, I will say I made the pilgrimage to Brittany to see Gavrinus for a particular reason for this, that it actually looks like they're showing complex acoustic wave. Well, I say acoustics, they could be drawing water waves for all we know. However, when you tie it in with other evidence, at other passage grave sites, these megalithic chambers, with the acoustics evidence, it's a natural conclusion to draw that they were drawing acoustic waves. But basically, it's the most decorated passage tomb we have. Gavrinie means Goat's Island in French, but it's on its own island. And it's got the most beautiful carved waves coalescing with each other, showing constructive and destructive interference. Some people said there's mathematical ratios drawn into it as well. This stuff is highly sophisticated artistic expression. And not only that, it's carved into granite as well. I mean, it's nearly every slab, nearly upright slab making up the chamber is carved as well. So when did our love affair with acoustics begin? You can go back into the Paleolithic area, you know, Peshmerga, Lascaux in France. What you find is you find that the cave art there, drawn 17,000 BC, 30,000 BC, this is what this stuff's going back to. Some of it's drawing the Summer Triangle and the Pleiades as well, and constellations. But what you find is that the subject matter that's drawn in those cave paintings is actually representing the acoustic effect that you hear in the cave at that present location. For example, if you see a red ochre hand print on the wall, you hear the sound, the echo coming back as a clapping hand. If you see a buffalo on the wall, you will hear the sound of running buffalo coming back as the echo. So they were drawing some sort of an acoustic interpretation of what they were actually drawing on the wall. Not only that, the artistic expression that these guys were leaving in the wall, they were drawing the shoulder of the buffalo as the rock that was jutting out. What's even more bizarre is that they went into really weird locations in the caves to do this rock art. I mean, sometimes up really high that was out of reach, or sometimes crawling on their back into a low crevice and painting in a really awkward place that would be very hard to see, just because that represented the acoustic effect. I personally think that, you know, in you need to have a right-brained culture to be expressing this stuff. And we're very, very limited because we're in a left brain culture today. We're handicapped in this world today because we think science, telescopes, stripy toothpaste, nuclear bombs and all that stuff. And that's what we think. We think that's the high tech civilization, that's the only way to be, electronics, all that stuff. And it's not, it's an imbalance. I don't think, take, for example, the ancient Egyptians. They had hieroglyphs, but they also had high-tech engineering as well. They had sophisticated, they had a balance of nature. They had the right brain and the left brain in harmony with each other. We just have this left-brain world that it's encouraged to be left-brained. And, you know, it handicaps us to look at any other culture or any other sophisticated system that's not left-brained. And it's a shame, really. It really is a shame.
Yes. Even when you're talking about, like, say, like acoustics, I always wondered, is it why they left music to be, it's like a universal language.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean? As in, when you speak about music, A in Britain is A in China. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And I always wondered if that was pointing us to something.
Well, in terms of the acoustics and the passage graves, megalithic chambers that I've been studying, I do think there was a specific reason. I think it was for an exploration of consciousness. And what I mean by that is there's two types of frequencies that occurs inside these monuments. You have theta frequencies. In other words, if you take a drum and you beat that drum at 4 times a second or 7 times a second. Now, I've done this in Loch Crew in County Meath in Ireland. To sustain a drum beat, I'm no drummer, by the way, but to sustain a drum beat at 7 times a second long enough for the effect to take charge, it's quite a physical feat. Like, 4 times a second, not so bad. 7 times a second, you're hitting what's called 7 hertz or theta frequencies. And that will actually change your, theta frequencies is the dream state, basically. That's what puts your mind into jelly. And I've had this where I've been in the recess of the acoustic of the chamber, exploring these acoustics and beating that drum at 7 times a second. I stepped out and my mind was relaxed. I was like in jelly mode. I've been in the King's Chamber doing acoustic testing as well, chanting and omming inside the granite sarcophagus. Not that I think it is a sarcophagus, but that's what it's named. Sets up an acoustic field there. Then that sets up an acoustic field inside the King's Chamber. And then the King's Chamber then resonates with the whole rest of the pyramid down the Grand Gallery. It's an acoustically tuned monument, probably the most sophisticated on the planet.
It's a machine, really, isn't it, James?
It is like a machine. It functions like a machine. It's got technical specifications like a machine. I've also been to the Hypogeum. I didn't get to test the acoustics out there, but it's long been known that the Hypogeum in Malta, another megalithic complex, if you will, it's a three-story cave system that resonates to the male vocal range. And this is the other acoustic I was going to say, that when you chant an om or make any sound, usually at the male vocal range, although I have found two passage graves that resonate at the female vocal range, but at about 110 hertz, you find a peak in the resonance. Now, how you actually measure this stuff, guys, is basically you get a tone generator, you get a box, electrical box, and it makes a tone, and you change the tone up and down, making it higher and higher and higher, and you get a decibel meter, and you measure inside the chamber, and you watch for a peak in the decibel, and you'll find that the resonance comes back and it coalesces and it enhances what you call as a resonance effect. And what happens is you get a peak at around 110 hertz, which is the male vocal range. So that's how you test these things. It's not rocket science. Anybody can do this. It's basic equipment. But all these megalithic chambers seems to be in or around the male vocal range. We even have the megalithic complex of the hypogeum, which is carved to look like the megalithic temples above ground. It's got a special niche on the wall where you arm or shout into it, and it makes the whole three-story cave system resonate. It's eerie. It's absolutely, if you can get this online, you'll hear it on YouTube. The sounds of prehistory, I think it's called, or the sounds of the hypogeum. You'll get it. But I have no doubt that's a deliberate acoustic design. This is what people are wrestling with. You can watch this, you can measure this, you can go and look at the most perfect example of the hypogeum, and they're still going, was this deliberate or was this accidental? If you're an acoustician or you're a physicist, you'll see an acoustic map of the place in your, you just have to look around and you'll see it. You'll see an acoustic map in your head of on acoustic design features. For example, in the hypogeum, again, they didn't carve doorways into the rooms, they carved windows. And basically, it's the same as, it's just like putting a bass box onto another bass box onto another bass box. They're linking up all these bass boxes. That's why the chambers resonate, because they didn't put doorways, they put windows, they put apertures going into the rooms. And then the archaeologists come up with this idea that you actually, they had steps going up to the windows, and it just doesn't make sense. You know, they said the ground level was higher inside, and now it's been cleared out. Where did it go? It's a three-story pit in the ground.
Okay, you know? James, I'm going to ask you to throw in some speculation. What do you think they were using it for?
I definitely think they were exploring their consciousness. And here's the thing: I mean, if you're chanting and omming and resonating, and you're beating drums, and it will affect your consciousness. That's no doubt. I've done acoustic tests with groups of people. When I did the astronomy research, I was aware of the acoustics. I'm not the first one to do this, by the way. There's many people. I just did ones in Ireland that hadn't been done, but people have been up to Maze Head. They've researched Stonehenge, the Ring of Brower as well. There's pockets of archaeoacoustics research going on. So I was well aware of this, and I did this alongside the astronomy. I just sat on it for a long time because I got overwhelmed with the astronomy part. But I've had no doubt that the Neolithic mind was exploring their consciousness. Why I say that is for two reasons. One, you can measure the acoustics of these monuments time and time again, and they're all hitting the male vocal range, and they're basically in harmony with the male vocal range. That's no mean feat of engineering. You can also see physical acoustic design features, like the long passageways being slightly different each time. Each monument is slightly different. It's like they were changing the shape of the bottleneck, if you want to call it that, to see what they could do with it. Then you also have the recesses with these strange little sills that they're not watertight. There's no structural function. Acoustically, there's a reason for it, but there's no other design feature that will be explained in terms of structural or waterproofing or anything like that. And they're actually quite a hazard to step over and get inside the recess. And then you also have rock art. Like, I come back to the rock art again. I was aware of the astronomy art. That's why I was researching it. But I came across another type of art, what we call entoptic phenomena. Now, Graham Hancock would have wrote about this in Supernatural 2006. And when I had read Supernatural, I didn't see entoptic phenomena as the art. I seen Newgrange. He was talking about these shapes and symbols that you see when you go into an altered state of consciousness, an ASC. And why you would be doing an altered state of consciousness may be psychedelics and entheogens. It may be an acoustic or chanting. Acoustics can be induced in an altered state of consciousness. When you listen to the harp, by the way, it can cure depression. It can cure It can put you into an altered state of consciousness if you want. It might be very, very mild compared to a psychedelic, but it's still possible. You can go into altered states of consciousness from rhythmic dance, starvation. You know, there's many forms to get there. It doesn't really matter how the journey. Psychedelics or entheogens are probably the most potent, the most traumatic, for sure. Probably the most known. But the point is that a lot of this art is showing entoptic phenomena. We're talking zigzags, spirals, lozenges, semicircles, circles, concentric circles. And there is a chart. You can look this up on Google Images, entoptic phenomena, and you'll get a list of about 40 images. Basically, there's a chart of about 40 images. There's grid squares and stuff like this and floating circles. If you walk around the perimeter of Newgrange after looking at a chart of entoptic phenomena, you'll see the same art. It's a no-brainer. Are people talking about this? Very few people. Is archaeologists talking about this? No. They won't even deal with the astronomy, never mind the entoptic phenomena. And they just
Sorry, I was just going to see the signs that you get, and especially, I mean, there's a load of them in Ireland as well, where it's like a spiral that's just coming out the way. Is that an acoustic symbol?
I wouldn't say so, no. I mean, I think that's personally an entoptic symbol. If you were to see like a sine wave or a sawtooth wave, like a zigzag wave, I would call that an acoustic symbol. And this is where it gets a bit murky, because are they entoptic or are they, because the zigzag wave is both acoustic and entoptic. In other words, visionary, or it could be used to represent a physical quantity or an acoustic effect. This is what I actually got into the research. I was fully sure I was going to prove this as acoustics. Because I was aware of the acoustic resonance of the chambers. I went and did some measuring.
James, could it even have been, I'm just thinking, sorry to cut you off there, but could it have been that these ancient cultures were somehow altering their consciousness and being given these symbols and then reproducing them in their art?
For sure. Well, I tell you what I did. I thought I would prove it as acoustics, or I thought I would prove it as an entoptic phenomenon, one way or the other. I was pretty naive, but at the time I thought I would, you know, being dogmatic and focused on my research, I thought I would could prove it one way or the other, or at least kind of lead in that direction. However, what I have realized now is that I'm pretty sure they were doing both. I think they were doing entheogens, psychedelics. We have one reference of the Hyperboreans, a group of people that basically Northern Europe was referred to as Hyperborea. Diodorus Siculus in 30 BC, he wrote about the Hyperboreans having a temple in the north. That temple in the north can be proven with 3 points of evidence that it's Callanish stone temple on the Outer Hebrides, which I've stood at, and it's pretty remote place. It's not about latitude 60. However, it's aligned to the Pleiades, it's got a lunar alignment, and it's on an island the size of Sicily. That was the three requirements for Diodorus Siculus's Hyperborean temple. What we also wrote about the Hyperboreans was that they had a hallucinogenic brew that they used to drink. So we have these Hyperboreans associated with a temple in the north. There is no other temple at latitude 60. It can only happen at latitude 60 because of the moon and the Pleiades alignment. That is the only place that that ring of latitude, that a temple will have those astronomical effects.
And being from the north of Scotland, James, I can assure you there's plenty psilocybin that kicks about up there in the form of the magic mushrooms.
Oh, for sure. And I've actually found psilocybin mushrooms growing. I have a little YouTube video of it. I found them growing about 15 feet from the front door of Loch Crew Carnell, if anybody wants to investigate around November time. But yeah, I mean, I have no doubt now, because we have a historical reference that the Hyperboreans had a hallucinogenic brew and that they had a temple in the north that you can prove was Callanish Stone Temple. That's anecdotal and it's conceptual, but it is evidence. Now, we also have acoustic evidence showing entoptic phenomena. So it's like, to be honest with you, if you look at the Aztec, the survivors of the Aztec culture in Mexico today, and shamans there, they use acoustics and psychedelics both together and to explore their consciousness. So it seems natural that they would have done both. Who's to say they only did it with acoustics? Who's to say they only did it with entheogens? That's maybe a simpler way of looking at it. I think the story is more complex than that. But either way, both are used to enhance one's consciousness into a state where you know, it brings on this altered state, and as a result, they're exploring their consciousness. We also have the Celts as well. We must point out there that the Celts inherited these monuments. We have several writings in the Gaelic language. There was an overlap of the Irish Celts and the megalithic builders by about 500 years. And they referred to them as the Shee, the people of the mounds. And they, you know, the Celts had several pieces of art and drawing the serpent. And, you know, if you talk to anybody who's taken ayahuasca or DMT compounds, where DMT occurs in many natural plants, that the serpents are the entities that present themselves whilst on psychedelic visions. A lot of the artwork is drawing serpents, and even in Gavrinis, they're drawing serpents on the art right beneath the acoustic waves as well. So I have no doubt that this whole murky story is dealing with acoustics and theogens, and serpents is another little line of inquiry that we can kind of tie it in together. It's bizarre. The whole story just gets more bizarre and more complex the more you look at it.
I wanted to ask you, James, if you don't mind, something that I've always been fascinated with is the pineal gland. And I really believe that that is some sort of gateway to consciousness. I've had loads of crazy experiences and stuff. Now, do you ever see any sorts of depictions or anything in the arts or anything that would suggest that maybe the ancient civilizations were playing with that sort of stuff too?
Sure. That's a good question, actually. I've actually had Rick Strassman on the show. I've been talking in depth about the pineal gland on and off the year. And, you know, I follow a lot of his work, and I definitely think that the pineal gland gets activated. There's a lot of people think that's a lot of speculation, and there's not enough proof on that. However, I'm pretty convinced there's a third eye there. It's called the pineal gland. I'll accept that. Whether they were drawing that in their art, I haven't seen any direct art of that in the megalithic culture.
The Vatican, they have a big problem.
They have a big pineal gland. Yeah.
And you know, actually, up where I'm from, James, just on a side note, Alistair Crowley, he had a house by Loch Ness, and I've actually been up and I've sneaked about the grounds of that, and sitting proudly in front of the actual front door is a big pine cone, a big statue of a pine cone.
Wow. I was actually only talking about Alistair Crowley on my last show, Capricorn Radio, the other day. I had Scotty Roberts and John Ward on.
And now I find this out with 7 minutes to go. You know, James, you're going to have to come back for one of our flagship Freaky Fridays.
Oh, I'd love to, brother. I'd love to.
Definitely. The next Friday you're available, you let me know, because 1 hour is not going to do you justice, sir.
Yeah, you know, let me just recap really on where my research led me. I mean, I'm in a trilogy of research. Firstly, I wanted to get going on the astronomy, and I did the acoustics research side by side with it, but I shelved it for a long time. It's only coming out now because I held off in the publishing of that Megalith Acoustics book. It's coming out this month, and but I did the research alongside it, and I just thought I would have to do it justice. I can't ignore one side of research when I'm doing the other, and I just don't see it being done properly, and I certainly see it being neglected in Ireland. By the way, Ireland's not the only place I've been to. I've been to nearly every megalithic country. I think Norway's the only one I haven't been to, but I've been to maybe 80 plus passage graves in Denmark. There's the Drenthe region. Holland's got 50 of them. All over Portugal, I've been down as far as Portugal, Spain, Brittany, England, Scotland, Wales, Ireland. You know, even in the German island of Den Haag as well. And you know, this stuff is just riddled across Europe. And it's only when you go to all these places that you see the acoustics anomalies either matching up, or the differences in astronomy and then the same astronomical design features as well. Another area of research for me, and I never thought I would be researching henges. I didn't think they were interesting enough, but there's numerology and mathematics encoded into the henges. That's my latest area of research. I hope to publish that in the new year. It's so revelatory. I'm actually astounded myself. I don't even find that deciphering a bit of rock art that's got some astronomy in it, because it's been done so many times. Somebody has figured out a lunar calculation, or somebody's figured out a solar calculation. What's another revelation about some astronomy? But the numerology of the henges, it is absolutely mind-blowing. It's showing advanced mathematics.
And the Kev Baker Show, Marty, do we love the numbers, whistles? Numbers are our thing, aren't they?
That's what I was going to say.
Oh, yeah.
we're no strangers to numerology on this show, and we'd absolutely love to hear your take, you know, on the whole numerology thing one night, because I believe there's so much more to the whole mathematics and the way everything works. You can see it in the rotations of the planets and certain, you know, measurements of alignments and everything. It's just absolutely fascinating, and I think there's so much more to it.
Let me just throw this one at you, okay? I'm fully convinced that the megalithic builders knew the circumference of the Earth, and I think they knew the polar circumference as well. Because the polar and the circumference, the polar circumference and the equatorial circumference are not the same. The Earth is an egg shape or an obloid. However, if you take the circumference of the Earth in feet, whatever it is, 131 million or something like that. But if you take the number 360,000, bear in mind that 360 is the number of degrees in a circle. So you take 360,000 and you multiply by the number of days in the year, you will get the exact circumference of the Earth, equatorial circumference, in feet. You know, so whoever has designed the unit of the foot in ancient times knew the circumference of the Earth, no doubt.
It just seems to be, you know, too many coincidences. It seems that some knowledge has really come from somewhere, you know, in these ancient civilizations, because, I mean, it would have took till many thousands of years later, wouldn't it, to be able to come up with the things that they did come up with. But and to be able to see certain planets in space that we couldn't see till we had telescopes. It's absolutely fascinating stuff.
Here's the thing. If you knew the circumference of the Earth, it's there in its number. It's like the unit of foot literally encodes the circumference of the Earth. However, the circumference of the Earth, if you want to take half the circumference of the Earth and put it at that latitude, wherever that is, or a quarter of it, it's not going to be right, because the circumference of the Earth at certain latitudes gets less and less and less. It because of the polar circumference is not the same. If it was a perfect sphere, well then, you would be able to predict what the ring of latitude is, its circumference at whatever latitude, but you can't, because the polar circumference changes that. I think that the megalithic builders knew that, and I think that's why they traversed from southern Europe up to northern Europe. I mean, they were up as high as latitude 70 in the top of Norway. Most people don't even realize that they were at the top of Norway. They were at the Arctic Circle, what we call the Arctic Circle, the edge of the Arctic Circle. That is a vast distance to cover in a civilization. I mean, the Romans wouldn't have even done that. I mean, even if they got to not past Scotland, they would have just sealed off at Scotland. They wouldn't have gone further north. It would have been too cold for them.
I don't blame them for not coming here, but I've unfortunately got to cut you off, James. Now, do you want to give your radio show and your websites a shout out?
Oh, sure. JamesSwagger.com for everything I do as an author. You'll see all the stuff linked up there as well. And CapricornRadio.com, you'll find my archive for my shows there as well, in which I talk to fellow researchers and authors as well, and hopefully learn a bit by other authors too. But CapricornRadio.com and JamesSwagger.com for everything I do.
Well, I'm hoping this is going to be the start of a good working relationship between the Kev Baker Show and James Swagger, because you have been absolutely fantastic tonight, James. I want you to check your diary for the next Friday you are available, because the chat room is buzzing. They want you back. They love you. We love you. Absolutely amazing, sir. Whistles, Marty. I've been blown away tonight. What about you guys?
This is probably the quietest I have ever been, honestly, because just listening to that was absolutely fantastic. Thanks very much, James.
Believe in coincidences.
I think you were definitely on the correct path, James. And the fact you got that book so randomly and then you were pointed in that direction, we call that a synchronicity here on TFR. And it seems to be that when people are on the right path, these little nuggets are left for us along the way.
It really did change everything for me. I mean, what I realized there and then was that it wasn't in the record, that it wasn't documented. I went... And the first thing I questioned myself was, I go, well, what else isn't documented? Obviously, I'm a problem solver. I'm like, well, you know, if I can find this in 2007, what else is out there? Now, I never did find anything in terms of an apparent, obvious revelation. But I did find other concepts. I did find other research not done very well, sometimes totally erroneous. And sometimes people had missed the whole point. I should say, a comment on my career. Why I do things differently is because I'm a systems analyst. I didn't start off as a systems analyst. I worked my way up to that. I started off as a time-served engineer, electromechanical. I've worked in electrical systems, electronic systems, and mechanical systems. I'm quite involved in my career, and that's why I have all those qualifications. In the end, I wanted to get out of the mechanic in Donegal in the northwest of Ireland, not properly documented, and it was not in the record as being recorded as the rock art of the constellation Ursa Major, Ursa Minor, and particularly to an equinox flipping between the every 21st of March, every 21st of September. Now, I have that in my book. It's called the Ardmore Equinox Stone. It's a bit of a discovery. It's not something you can write a book on. I thought it was a curious anomaly. I researched the record. I couldn't find anything about it. And this was about 2007. So that was one major thing. I had a serendipitous event while I was actually researching that rock art. Long story short, I bought a really rare book when I couldn't even afford to buy, you know, my dinners that time. Like I was struggling to eat, and I bought a $150 book. But I used to research rare books and buy. It's an addiction I have, buying rare books. And it comes from America, it's called Hamlet's Mill, Hershey von Decker and Giorgio de Santiano, researching ancient astronomy and ancient cultures all around the world and mythologies and linking it all together. And it's like the archaeoastronomy Bible, if you will. And I got a copy, comes from America, out pops, when it gets here, out pops a photocopy from a New Scientist magazine from 1976, July, the year and month I was born. I went, wow, what the hell is this? And when I looked in it, it gave me this location of this piece of rock art in Donegal. And I couldn't believe it. I went, oh, that's just across the lock. That's just across the water from where I'm at. I went on a 50-mile cycle. I love cycling, and I went on this 50-mile cycle around the lock, and I called in halfway around it. And when I got there, I was stunned. Great, beautiful rock art constellations. This is great. I didn't know we had this in our backyard. It's only when I went home that I tried to research thing. I couldn't find anything on it. Now, I had looked at megaliths when I was from a teenager till I was in my mid-20s. I hadn't got the academic interest in it, but I had since done an astronomy degree, not for the pursuit of my career that I'm in now. It's just I wanted to make a change from engineering, and I ended up researching rock art as a result of this constellation. It's just ironic that, you know, I for all the wrong reasons I was there, but I had all the right skill sets at that time. And perhaps that serendipity was a moment of truth in my life. I don't know. I don't believe.
Wow, this show here tonight could go in a whole host of directions, but I want to ask you what actually first got you into this line of work, James.
Yeah, I always wanted to be an author, and I refused to do it because I didn't have the skill set when I was young. I was always kind of wanting to be a writer when I was early 20s, but I wasn't stupid either. I knew I had an academic skill set as an engineer and science, and that was my vocation. And I went, I'm not a writer, I'm a scientist, I'm an engineer. And I put my eggs in that basket, and I pursued that. The reason I wanted to be a writer was I had been reading. I'm an avid reader of all sorts of mysteries, megaliths, anomalies, ancient Egypt, Babylonian, Sumerians, anything to do with ancient civilizations. I like from the Romans and beyond. Anything after the Romans, I don't like. That's my personal that's my personal hobby, to research ancient civilizations. It's always been in me. But I'm good at math, and I'm good at science, and I need to work. And that's what I put my my energy into when I was in my 20s. However, I kind of came back to where my roots was in a way. And I found myself researching megaliths for all the wrong reasons. I never, ever thought I would be writing about megaliths one day. by the time I was 30, for a multitude of reasons, I won't get into them all, but there's a couple, but for a multitude of reasons, I found myself researching and everything that I do, my science, my engineering, and my skill set, researching as a systems analyst, all came into play. And then I put the whole thing together to research the megaliths. And it's like I have all my skills and passions all in one now. And it's just a wonderful woven mix of everything I am and everything who I am. There was one incident where I found rock art.